Did you eat the skipper?
You better pray to the god of skinny punks that this wind doesn't pick up, because I'll come over there and jam an oar up your ass.
Yeah, mic check, 1, 2.
They see me rolling, they hating, patrolling, they trying to kiss me.
Rum and nerdy,
kiss me, 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 rum and nerdy.
Whenever I'm about to do something, I think, would an idiot do that? And if they would, I do not do that thing.
You wanna play? I'll play. This is the way.
Ready to program!
Let's go!
Hey everybody, welcome to Rum and Nerdy. I'm Greg.
And I'm Garrick.
And today we have episode 2.27, Little Buddy. And we have a buddy.
Hey, little buddy.
Hey, buddy.
We have Sean. Sean's back.
Hey there.
What's going on?
You guys invited me, so I came over.
It's been a day. Yeah, actually, it was more of a dare than an invite.
That's true.
Hey, Sean, we double dare you to come by here on Sunday, or whatever day it was.
Well, yeah, I mean, the first invite was, I think you alluded to it, you mentioned the other day, like, hey, Sean should be on the show, and then I heard the podcast after you had mentioned I should have been there, so it was like I was already late. So I
we never
make
heard
it.
From you. So, well, and our whole thing was we were not going to warn you. We were going to like
see if
test the fact, because you're usually like by Friday afternoon you're like you text me, oh this was funny on the episode or whatever. So yeah. It's like never heard from you.
Yeah, but I was on a plane and it was a busy couple of days, so I didn't even get to listen to it until my way home, and then I realized missed it.
Oh man, I was supposed to be there. And ironically enough, I was the one that was late. So
it's like getting an Outlook invite that shows up late after you've already meeting was supposed to happen.
Oh, the stealth invite.
Yeah, and also the meeting reminder comes up. Hey, you should have been at this meeting an hour ago. I'm like, but it wasn't on my calendar. It just happens.
Yeah. Somebody usually forwards it to you. Yeah, I forgot to send this to you. It's cool if you join, right? No.
Live and die by that calendar. It's like even tomorrow, like you know, and this is always the worst. It's like you've got a big client that sends you a meeting invite for a follow-up kickoff meeting, and you're like, yeah, no, like I'm already double booked at that time, but this other person will help you.
Why can't you see my calendar? Yeah, get on that Outlook. Can people outside of your Exchange server see what your calendar looks like? Now, maybe not read the meeting titles, but at least, hey, available, not available.
Yeah. Even if just like a box when you're setting up. Yeah, totally. That, yeah, they can see my calendar.
And actually, I have coworkers that don't know about that. So, podcast audience, if you're in Outlook and you go to scheduling assistant, you can see if the person you're scheduling a meeting with is available or not. And if they're not available, don't invite them to the meeting.
Right.
Or specifically if it's like a one-on-one, like, hey, you and I need to talk about a thing right on top of something else.
So I almost got conned into, it's a new marketing sales tool when places want to sell you things. They'll just send you a random meeting invite. Hi, this is Sally from I Want to Be Like Salesforce.com.
Mm-hmm.
And let's have a meeting and talk about, you know, me using your company. I don't know who this person is, but the random invite shows up in your calendar. And if you don't know you're supposed to accept or not accept, all of a sudden you're on somebody's calendar and you're going to have a cold call invite. And it happened like 3 times last month.
Well, we were talking... You were talking about spam text messages earlier, and I'm assuming that this happens to everybody during an election year.
Yeah, they're all election, yes.
So I have found the absolute best response for spam text messages.
Okay.
It's an actual automated response you get. If you text a landline, so it reads, you know, +1, then whatever your phone number is a landline number. Reply Y to send all text messages to this number as voice messages for 25 cents per message, plus standard messaging fees. Details at vtext.com, text to landline. And it's a canned thing that you just get back whenever you text a landline. Just keep that, copy and paste it, and whenever anyone spam texts you, just immediately fire it off. I've seen a noticeable decrease in the number, because as soon as they get that response, like, oh, well, that's a landline, delete it from our text messaging system.
I need this.
Yeah, it's kind of amazing. Yeah.
Okay, I need that.
Yeah, it works.
Usually wait.
Usually it's just unsubscribe.
Did we just do something useful on the show?
Yeah, don't do that again.
Okay.
It's like a paradox. I'm here.
We can only be useful when Sean's in the house.
You know, I know Aaron's not here, but when you guys mentioned, you know, simulation things.
You actually met him for the first time last night.
I did. The Central Florida Rum Council, which I'm now trying to be regular at that as well. It's a thing. As soon as you said, oh yeah, we have a guy. And sadly enough, back in late 90s, when we played Descent, which back then was, the networks were token ring guys, 10 megabits. You had three friends tied into LAN card.
You had me at token ring.
Yeah. And so Descent was played in this office that I was in, and we actually drafted and were starting to build said simulator, which is just a chair, and took all the inputs from the joystick controller. Yeah. So it wasn't great simulation, but at least gave you like a three-axis fighter chair that you could play the game with on our crappy, like, you know, CAD 27-inch CRT CAD monitors that get off enough heat to warm a coffee cup. So, and there were three of us playing that in a room for hours and hours and hours.
That's freaking awesome.
So yeah, that was kind of fun days.
You do have the technology.
And it was cheap.
Well, like by today's dollars cheap, or?
Just cheap, generally cheap. We actually built everything out of surplus parts, went to Skycraft. And you just kept going to Skycraft for weeks until we could find enough parts and pieces. Like, yeah, we make that work. Sure.
Wow.
It's like, hey, dude, I got a bitchin' set of tools. I can fix that.
So Skycraft holds its own, you know, Skycraft locally for non-Central Florida residents. It's a surplus store. Just random parts.
Also referred to as Skycrap.
Skycrap, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's an amazing, it's like Toys R Us for junk. It's just absolutely amazing. It's almost like that shop in the movie Explorers where they got all the stuff from. That's like the closest analog I can imagine. Anyway, but because it's in Central Florida, you get random stuff there from the theme parks, and you get random stuff there from NASA.
Yeah.
Every now and then you'll be going through stuff and like, wow, this voltmeter has a NASA asset tag on it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to buy it just because of that.
It's funny there. Many years ago, so they're talking to them. I said, why did you start getting stuff? He goes, well, you know, back in the day, Central Florida and actually the whole I-4 corridor was a major electronics manufacturing arm.
Really?
For major military defense. From Space and Strategic on the Space Coast, Titusville, Cocoa, all the way to Pinellas County, St. Pete and Clearwater, where there's like E-Systems, Raytheon, Honeywell.
Oh, yeah.
And AT&T was here in Orlando as a manufacturing sub. All that stuff had to get recycled and bought up, and Skycraft used to buy. And this could be folklore, but the story I was told, they go around, they just buy all that stuff because they can only use it for a certain amount of time, then it all gets replenished. Mm-hmm. And they would buy all of it and then recycle the copper and the motors and widgets and everything else, relays, tubes, you know, octa sockets, you know, 5-pin socket, 8-pin socket base, all that stuff.
As a prop maker, I would go in there all the time. We did a really fun project that I did for ABC, and this is kind of like one of my what's that, total blacked out, that show,
you're terrible at this, Greg.
Yeah, I know.
The show with the
Mythbusters. My Mythbusters moment. So I got hired by a company that was doing some work for ABC. They were down here for the BCS college college game at the Citrus Bowl,
Capital One Spirits Bowl, yeah.
And basically this trophy, which is this black monolithic kind of 18-inch tall black thing, whatever, and it has three aluminum pins that hold up a crystal football that sits on top of it. So, you know, I had my shop build the trophy itself, and they brought the little plant-on play. They said, hey, we'll make an extra one of those.
Yeah, and so, they came to you to hire you to build the fake prop for this gag.
Yeah, so what I did was I ended up doing just a channel, a slide on the inside that went up and down, and used I went to Skycraft and the things I bought there were a 12 volt power window motor.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got the little arm that comes out that does it. So I built it with the slot so that as it rotated, it would just do the carrier straight up and down. Mm-hmm. And on that carrier, I mounted the aluminum pin. I did the timer relay that I bought there, as well as the socket, everything else, wired everything up, and found they had a packaged aftermarket keyless entry setup that you could put on your car. So you had the little fob.
Yeah.
And I wired it all up together, built the system, and the photographer that was taking pictures for this gag just had the fob double-sided Velcro taped on the back of the camera. Mm-hmm. So the photographer was actually hitting the button. Every time he hit it, the pin would lower down and raise right back up where it went. So the crystal football would fall off and shatter. And it's Regis was there doing the whole thing, and he, you know, and the whole gag was like, okay, get the football out there, pose with them. Football would crash and shatter behind him, and Regis would be like, dude, you just bumped the table. And everybody in the room is freaking out. and this was the morning of pre-show thing that they did on ABC.
I wonder if this exists on YouTube somewhere.
Oh, that would be funny. That if it would does, be funny. That was my prop. I built that prop.
And for the listeners out there, we're sitting here watching Greg use his hands like charades. So that entire process that we just experienced was him look like a marionette puppet running his hands around the microphone and explaining all the little bits and parts.
I am an animated storyteller. Shut up. Are Jazz you looking hands. It up?
BCS trophy? Yeah.
Oh, my God. Skycraft is pretty darn awesome.
And have they moved yet? I know that they were...
They did. They're now on the corner of Lee Road and Edgewater, which if you know that area is where the horse track used to be,
mm-hmm.
It's like right in that wedge of that piece of dirt. Well, dirt. I mean, the OBT is not a big major highway there, and the big flyover bridge. All that stuff in that area changed.
Yeah.
But they're in this old shopping center behind the post office there in Edgewater.
Nice. Did they save their spaceship sign?
No. It's not that building, so I don't know. I don't know if it's still on Fairbanks or they moved it.
They moved right down the road. They had an issue with the UFO spaceship sign thing because it's not hurricane rated. Mm-hmm. Like
grandfathered at the new building.
Exactly. Yeah. So, which is disappointing.
Building codes
because it's building codes. Kind of a UFO icon.
Yeah.
Sign codes.
Stupid codes enforcement. Hey. I know it's a little early, but can we hit a break early? Because I want to get a refill. I found a rum I'd never heard of, and looking at the reviews, this might actually be a decent freaking rum.
Really?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Yeah, there's on we'll talk about it when we get back.
We need more glasses, though. We have to go neat, and I've already got Coke out.
I have that technology.
Okay.
We'll be right back. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to The Refill. And this one's kind of interesting. So I found today's rum randomly. I was out in Daytona, went to a liquor store to pick up some stuff, and I saw this. I'd never even remotely heard of this before. It's called Noxx Dunn 245.
And they use the fancy little and symbol.
It actually looks like the Brooks & Dunn logo.
It does. Kind of. Like,
yeah.
That's it.
That's clever.
So
Straight Barrel.
This is... 2 years ago when Campari purchased 3Y and 3Ray and Nephew, they terminated the Appleton Estate sales team here in Canada. I don't understand what this is saying. I'm just going to skip that. This is a rum, and it comes in a bottle.
Thanks, Wikipedia.
Yeah. This is words lined up, and I don't understand.
Like that. Appleton rum, or Appleton, Wisconsin, or Appleton, Jamaica? What
are we talking Appleton Estates. I'm assuming it's Appleton Estate rum from Jamaica.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Something to do with that. They created it. It's made from a blend of 100% Florida sugarcane molasses, pot and column distilled spirits. These rums were aged for 2, 4, and 5 years in subtropics in Florida, of course, in one used bourbon barrel. Importantly, no flavoring and no coloring were added. So this is a very traditional style. The color and flavor of the rum in the bottle is completely natural and derived from the aging process. The final rum was bottled at 43% alcohol by volume. So that's this is from the Rum Howler blog. If we go over to rum ratings, this is kind of interesting. It's all over the place. 24 ratings has got a 6.0. Ironically, it's a 6.0, but not one rating of 6. It's either rated 3, 4, 5, or there's a lot of high ratings up in like the 9 and 10. My guess is that it has a lower rating because this is probably, based on the description, a much more traditional rum. And a lot of people, I think, are used to seeing the... I didn't use my first glass, so.
Oh,
The well, I'll give you that back then. Anyway, I think a lot of people aren't used to having those post, are used to having those post sweetened and processed rums.
Yeah, this is
definitely smells Jamaican.
I bet. Oh yeah. That's interesting. So, very nice amber, very almost gold color. Good color in the glass. It's kind of interesting because it's more amber in the bottle than it is in this glass, but
because there's more in the bottle.
Well, it's also shaded by the label too, so it's a little bit of darker caramely color in the bottle.
It smells like it's going to have a little bit of burn to it.
It absolutely does.
Yeah.
That is
Jamaican rum.
Yeah, it is. It's definitely purple mixed with it.
Wait, did you say it has purple mixed with it?
No, I said it reminds me of things that are mixed with purple in it. Like when you go to Jamaica, the all-inclusives. Would you like the purple monkey? Oh, sure. What kind of rum? Anyone you got back there. And you mix it, and it's a color, and that's what you drink.
So this is,
it's got some bite.
Is very much like a Foursquare. I mean, I'm tasting, like, it's not what most people would taste this, and it's like, it's coming across very much, it drinks like a whiskey.
It does, because it's got a very good numbing factor to the back of your throat.
Mm.
Now, don't take it the wrong way. It feels like NyQuil after you chug real fast. It's like that.
Wow, yeah. Whoa.
You know what I mean? I mean, it's almost like I the back of my tongue right now is slightly numb. Like almost antiseptic numb.
Isn't that what happens immediately before you start going blind?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. I don't know that this is going to be a sipper, but again, this is neat. This is nothing but a glass.
Well, I've tried it neat, actually.
You know what? Second sip was way better than the first.
Second sip, better than the first. Yeah, it's got
it's not bad. It's just
that's not bad. It's complex.
I know, but it's more of a whiskey than it is a rum.
Yeah,
actually, it's more like a cheap bourbon than it is anything else.
Yeah,
that's fair.
Yeah, I mean, it feels more like a cheap bourbon.
We should get Warren's take on this.
Yep,
I'm cubing it.
Do it. Let me see that bottle. I didn't have a very heavy pour.
There. I'll recycle my cubes over here.
Oh, well.
Did you hear when we offered Aaron to... what sound does that bottle make? I don't know what you're talking
about. Well, yeah. Well, pop? Like, yeah, open it. Just yeah. Oh, you want the cubes over here.
Yeah, and he goes, boink.
Aaron.
I'd feel bad and says, yeah, he's going to listen to this. And it's like, but he doesn't actually listen to the podcast. Why did we let him be on twice in like two consecutive weeks?
That helps.
Well, the second time was because we had a pre-meeting about workety-work type stuff. And then he happened to bring rum to that, and it was a rum we hadn't tried. And we were going to record anyway. And
we had two rums.
It just happened.
We had two, yeah. And we didn't want to feel like a jerk. Like, hey, thanks for stopping by with this awesome rum. We're going to
So it was like an incidental recording.
Yeah, we're going to drink it without you leave. Yeah. No, yeah. it was on the schedule. But.
Yeah. That helps. The cube helps a little bit.
Yeah, it drinks better cold.
Yeah.
And I, you know what? And I don't know if it's just the drink I was consuming earlier, but it might have just been...
So you threw the ice cube directly onto the floor.
It might have just been harsh compared to the palate of what I was consuming earlier.
What were you consuming earlier?
Ice water with Mio in it.
Ice water with Mio.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The purple. You added purple to water.
Yeah, I had purple water. Kind of what you were just talking about. It's Jamaican purple water. Yeah,
it's like purple.
Yeah.
Okay. I added Coke to mine.
You did?
Because I feel this is a rum and Coke kind of rum.
I'm really surprised that these are being rated really, really high. And I think that that's kind of funny because this is not my favorite rum.
No. No, this is. To quote Greg, of all the rums I've ever had, this is the latest.
Yeah, this is most recent. Oh, you know what else?
Hmm.
Apparently, there's more kinds because I'm reading the review for the Noxx and Dunn 245, and we're drinking the straight barrel.
We are drinking the straight barrel.
So let me see.
You know, the Coke helps it.
Yeah. It's funny.
Not that kind of Coke, but yeah.
Every single thing that we do to it makes it better.
Yeah.
Gotta try another rum. Here, try the rum. No.
I mean, it's not my favorite.
Mm. No, there's some... I. You know what? I don't like when rums try to be sophisticated.
It's rum.
It's rum.
I disagree with that.
I don't like when rums try to be...
One word, Facundo.
It's not trying to be sophisticated, though.
I disagree.
Facundo's a Solera, isn't it?
I don't think it is, but...
I don't think it's a single barrel.
I don't know what these words mean.
I thought you listened to our show.
I do, but I act like I know.
You fast forward or just...
No. I just...
Get to the rum part and you're like, skip.
No. I listen to you guys and I try to absorb that, but I am not... I'm not a fifth level sommelier. You know, I don't know alcohol.
Well,
like
the first
alcohol.
Time you came, you did bring Kraken.
So. Oh yeah.
But it's
well,
it was free.
So the Solera process.
Touché.
It's a blend.
Yeah.
So they go to the barrels in the stack and they mix, you know, the high barrels with the low barrels, different ages. It's basically
no. I understand you're mixing. Yeah, you guys eloquently. Explained, you know, the oak cask and the Chardonnay cask and the aging and the blend. And if it was a New York blend or a Chicago and it was stored on a ship and it gets there and you mix it together and the oldest one is the youngest one and you mix the 2 and the 10, you get 7. I mean, I tried to.
That basically summarizes everything. Yeah, what do you mean you don't know?
I pay attention, but I can't take that.
That
analog input, I can't take that and say, oh, it tastes like this. My Renaissance brain doesn't take math to the taste. That's where I'm at. It's like, okay, I get the math. I understand how you get to the name.
Yeah. Okay.
I just don't know how to quantify that into, oh, it's got a nice note on my nose and some burn. And that equals a blah, blah, blah year. I don't know how to get there.
Yeah. And we just, we'll sip it and go like, oh, yeah, this smells like raisins.
Or worse.
Oh, God. Kind of what we do.
This tastes like dirt that's been fucked by a hobo.
You know, and
it's
since
the
we're coming up
of rums. Last week when I heard that, I darn near spit out my ice cube.
I love Malort is just
Malort is awful.
Malort is the adjective that I use to describe everything terrible.
And the thing is, unless you have experienced Malort and you've had the oh my god and you're looking for a trash can to spit it out, unless you've experienced that in your lifetime, it's hard to quantify Malort as an adjective.
And Malort, available at Total Wine.
Oh my god,
and,
it's awful.
And I will be perfectly honest. If you haven't experienced Malort, don't. You're better off having.
I one of my coworkers. I went on a rant when we got back from Chicago. I had to have gone on like a 20-minute Malort is the worst thing I've ever tasted in my life rant, and I had one of my coworkers went out and bought a bottle of Malort because he's like, no, I had to try it.
So
you had so much to say about it being so bad. He's like, I didn't think it could be as bad as you were making it out to be.
So you know how you can modify mouse clicks in Windows and you can like put a sound bite to the keyboard action otherwise?
It was all the rage in 1998.
Right. So that's where I used to live, right? So
you used to live in 1998?
No, but things like, like Winamp or whatever.
It really whips the llama's ass.
But after that episode when you guys were talking about Malort, I took a quick sound bite of that and on the key click to shut AutoCAD. It was like, it melted the wax off the cup. And that was the closing sound of me when I shut down AutoCAD.
Oh, that's fucking awesome.
And I lived with it for a while until IT changed on my laptop and it went away.
So
it's like, it's gone. The sound bite's gone. It's just, but there's people who heard me shut down the conference room. They're like, what was that? I'm like, it's just a soundbite that brought back a memory. That's all.
I'm glad that I was associated with turning off a drafting program.
Yeah, that's pretty funny.
That's hilarious. While we're talking about this, here's another bit that we need an intro for. The TikTok report.
Okay. Greg's TikTok report?
Yeah. Oh, so
where he gets all his current news.
I don't get my news from it. I just get funny things in it. So I get this guy's rating the top five highest alcohol content liquors sold in the United States.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so on that top five, one of them was actually a rum, and it's Rivers Royale Grenadian White Overproof.
Oh, this Grenadian?
This is the one you were talking about.
Yeah. Because you've got it incoming from this other thing. So it is like less than one full percentage less than Everclear.
Wow. That's got to hurt.
Yeah. And Everclear was 3. This was 4. So it's equivalent of 181 proof or something like that.
So like one step below carburetor cleaner.
Actually, the funny thing is this guy, when he was talking about this top five, all of the top five had a higher alcohol content than the rubbing alcohol you'd get in a pharmacy.
Wow.
Oh.
That's insane to me.
You could use that as an aftershave.
Anyway, so if anybody's going to Grenada again,
yes.
Bring us back some of this.
So, yeah. Yeah, we won't spoil. Well, no spoilers here, but there is a bottle inbound hand carried by a friend for the show.
Ooh.
We love you, Julie.
I don't think she listens yet.
Not yet, Penn.
Yeah.
Confirmed. Facundo's a blend.
Facundo's a blend.
Extraordinarily hand-blended sipping rums.
Oh, well, we knew it was a blend.
Yeah.
I just didn't think it was a Solara.
It's not a Solara, but it's a blend. Gotcha. But my point was, whenever like, this is single barrel specialty, blah, 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 and you try doing it with a rum, it's like, don't try to be whiskey rum. Try to be rum.
I don't know what that face. Like you're like, just don't try and be a whiskey, be a rum. And you went.
It looked like he's almost did a Mike Myers thing, but forgot the binky. Like,
I think I burped. I don't know.
I don't know what it was either, but I'm like, that doesn't play on a podcast. They're listening. But I mean, it was interesting though.
Oh, reading the episode. It's the episode where the hand gestures were never recorded. So much hand talking and face talking on here. And I'm sorry, we didn't record that on radio. You have a face for radio.
You know, it's
isn't that a Scissor Sister song? You can't see tits on the radio.
I don't know.
Scissor Sisters, yeah.
Well, Scissors.
Twisted Sister?
Scissor Sisters.
Oh, Scissors.
Oh, jeez.
They're shiny, if you've ever seen them live.
We've gone someplace on this podcast today.
Yeah. A lot of music. We've been talking about a lot about music off...
The Ice Cube with the Coke cell.
Mic, yeah.
Yeah.
You know what? We're halfway in. Let's take a quick break and come back and then talk about something else.
Copy.
As I, here, I'm going to do the face thing again. Okay. We'll be right back. Hello, hello, hello. Oh, welcome back. I think I sent you a TikTok. Speaking of TikToks, I think I sent you a TikTok midweek about Star Wars Tales number 19.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, you did.
Okay. So for the listeners, this came out, I want to say it was early 2000s, like 1999, somewhere in there. And it's kind of like if they did a Star Wars What If.
Mm-hmm.
If you remember the What If series, well, I mean, they've got the show now, so everybody knows what it is. And it's interesting because it's a story that centers around Han Solo and Chewbacca and the Millennium Falcon. Mm-hmm. They're trying to get away from the Empire, and something goes wrong with the quirky ship, and they go way, way, way off course to an uncharted planet that nobody, like, it's not in any systems. They don't know where they're at. They crash in a jungle. Indigenous people are there and they're trying to survive, get the Falcon, the world take off again. And in this process, Han Solo is killed by the indigenous people.
Okay.
Basically shot with arrows.
Okay.
120 years ago, or 120 years later, rather.
Yeah.
Chewbacca survives, you know, and he lives in the jungle and everything. 120 years following, you know, Han Solo passing away. Indiana Jones discovers the remains of the ship as he is going through the Central American jungles of the Americas hunting Bigfoot.
Which is Chewbacca. That is freaking awesome.
Yeah. That's a weird story arc.
Yeah.
No, that's an awesome story arc.
That is an awesome story arc when you look at Harrison Ford, finds the remains of Harrison Ford.
Right.
And
it's a paradox.
Can you imagine
Bigfoot.
Chewbacca and Indiana Jones hanging out? That'd be awesome.
Yeah, no, that would be great. That would be absolutely great. Hey, and hey, speaking of random stuff, 5 hours ago.
5 hours ago.
From the time that we recorded Picard season 3, the final season.
God, I hope it's better than the other one.
The trailer just dropped.
I like the show.
I liked season one. Season two, so I'm hoping this one's better.
I thought I didn't hate season one. Look, I enjoy new content. So I really enjoyed having new content. Mm-hmm. I really enjoy the production value because they put everything behind it. So if you having watched early 90s Star Trek The Next Generation and just the step from there to now, it's just, everything is just beautiful.
Oh yeah, it's gorgeous. And CG helps that up.
Yeah. You know? But season one, there were some elements that felt forced.
Yeah.
And season two, I enjoyed season two, but I don't know. I enjoyed season two.
Season two didn't feel like all the cameos were forced. Season one felt like, oh, we should include this character because, oh, Deanna Troi, you should show up now. Boop, and there you are. It's like, it just felt like that there was people showing up for whatever reason because they should.
Yeah.
You watched the trailer. Is it just, you know, like sounds or is there dialogue? Is it worth playing the trailer?
There's not a lot of dialogue.
So
there's
it wouldn't translate.
Yeah. There's a lot of visuals, but yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on, and it looks like, you know, Picard and Riker get back together, and they get on they're on board a starship going on a mission to do something. But it looks it looks really good.
The reviews that I had heard from people that had seen it in the editing process had said, this is 1,000% the punctuation on Picard and that crew and all of that lore coming back together.
That's outstanding.
Not that lore is in it.
Not lore specifically, but lore in the abstract.
That would be a reach.
Well, final season. So it's billed as season 3, the final season for Picard. Yeah.
Which means there's just like two more after this.
Well, and truthfully, I'm okay with it because Strange New Worlds kicks so much ass.
Yeah. It's quite funny. And I've not seen all of that, but I've seen enough episodes that I'm like, it's quite good. Crazy.
Strange New Worlds is the Star Trek that we have been waiting for this whole time when they've been doing the Paramount Plus reboot stuff. It's no, this is what you should have been making the whole time.
Yeah, no, and it's basically like, hey, this is the original Star Trek if Captain Kirk didn't command it. Like in the pilot, you had Captain Pike. Mm-hmm. This is Captain Pike's ship. And you interact, like they, you know, you actually do this process with Kirk, and it in the series, there is this whole juxtaposition on how differently the two of them are as far as captains. Kirk is very brash and he's you know, like fly by the seat of his pants, and mm-hmm. Pike is very methodical and calculated. Star Trek Strange New Worlds adds Carol Kane as new engineer.
I saw it today.
How awesome is that?
I mean, Carol Kane, I mean, that could either be really, really funny or really, really funny.
Wow.
Have fun storming Kronos.
You think it'll work?
It'll take a miracle.
It'll take a teleporter.
It'll take a miracle.
It'll take a tricorder.
For the three people that get that joke, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's really, that's nerd fusion right there.
I loved her in Taxi.
I loved her. Actually, did you see the TV show Gotham?
No, it's on my list.
It is really, really good.
You haven't seen Gotham? For a person that doesn't watch a lot of TV, I've seen enough episodes of Gotham that enjoy it.
Yeah.
She plays the Penguin's mother.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Mrs. Gobblepot?
Yeah.
Gobblepot?
Cobblepot.
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 Or baby Christian. Buggy bumpers.
I was using. There's a peanut in my papa gosh.
Yeah, she was also hit in the head with the electronic organizer in Seinfeld.
Okay,
I know that.
I was not aware.
I'm like useless IMDb knowledge over here.
We need to bring.
She also once had a taco on the set of a movie she did with Mel Brooks.
Did you watch Stargate SG-1?
Oh yeah. I went through the whole, last episode you guys went through the whole chronology, which ones you should watch and when there.
And that's a whole Garrick thing. I have not watched hardly any of them.
So
Stargate SG-1 is awesome.
Tilk's friend, Braytek, the commanding guy.
You're asking for names? Okay, I know.
The old guy that Tilk hung out with.
Yeah,
he played Saul Bass in Seinfeld, the old guy that Kramer confused for Salman Rushdie.
Oh my god!
Yeah, that's him. And I posted that. Somebody posted a thing on an SG-1 fan site. They're like, oh, I just he was in, you know, because he was in some actual movie as an actual part. And I'm like, oh yeah, he was great in Seinfeld. And I just posted the picture of him and Kramer in a sauna. And everyone's like, what the fuck? What?
See, whenever we talk about all the sci-fi genre stuff, I go back to Galaxy Quest. Right?
Yeah.
It's like my all-time favorite sci-fi movie. And a couple reasons why. One, Tim Allen's hilarious. But second of all, the alien that's in there not only is our friends from The Office there, Rainn Wilson's in that.
Yep.
But Missy Pyle is in that.
Yeah.
Missy Pyle plays the other alien woman, mm-hmm. who's the ingenue.
Yeah, yeah.
She's actually my classmate at school.
Seriously?
Yeah. At North Carolina School of the Arts. She and she actually has a really awesome band out west called Smith and Pyle. And she's
I heard about this.
She's an awesome musician, one, but she's incredible actress, everything, you know, LA Confidential, Mission Quest. She plays Violet Blue's mom in Willy Wonka Chocolate Factory.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, she's just an incredible character actor.
Yeah.
And anyway, whenever I see her in movies, I'm like, ah, I knew you when we were like both like just out of teenagers and we're all school, you know, classmates.
Worst lab partner ever.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Actually,
she could have been a great lab partner. I don't know.
Last time I see her, had her perform live, she was in Tennessee Williams' Commando Royale.
Yeah.
Which was one of my master thesis show, if you call that anything. It's at school. And she was performed in that. It was quite amazing. Stage actress.
But is she a good person?
She's an awesome person. Like, heart of gold, awesome, amazing person. It's like, somebody you'd always want to be around. I'm just freaking one of those amazing people that, like, super talented and a good person. It's hard to find that in today's world.
I was kind of hoping there'd be, like, a good story. Oh, yeah, she's terrible. She's...
Nah. Heart of gold.
She used to steal my milk.
She used to throw rocks at pigeons.
No, she'd give you the nickel off, you know, she'd give you the shirt off her back.
I was about to say, she'd give you the nickel off, and then I saw you spinning the wheel.
Yeah.
It's like that little colorful Macintosh I'm thinking wheel.
Yeah, ding, ding, like bad analogy. Bad analogy.
Make it like a tree. And get out of here.
How are you going to back out of this one?
Yeah. But yeah, but then, you know, and then I saw her again in a dodgeball.
Yeah.
With Ben Stiller. And I'm like, oh, yeah. Her and Ben have done a number of movies together. And it's like, she's just freaking hilarious.
I didn't realize that she was in that movie. If you can dodge a wrench, you can dodge a ball.
Thanks, Zeke.
Yeah.
Well, I'm out of things to talk about. This has been Rum and Nerdy. And
thanks for inviting me, guys. Worth the drive over in the rain. Okay.
I was going to say too, just randomly, I was going to say this. I am now on season 4 of Torchwood, and we're just about finished season 5 of Saul.
Which Torchwood is sort of the Doctor Who spinoff. It's really good. It's take Doctor Who meets X-Files is kind of where it's
I've never watched Doctor Who.
Oh, well,
you're missing out
on the greatest sci-fi show ever, right?
That involves like a telephone booth and stuff, right? In an airplane.
Yes, exactly.
I've never followed Doctor Who. I'm sorry.
That's fine. Not everybody can be awesome. We get it.
That is definitely Sean. I'm not awesome.
Torchwood, you said season 4?
It's going to be on your tombstone. Sean, not awesome.
Oh, my God.
Which one's season 4? Is that... you haven't gotten to Children of Man.
Children of Corn? What?
Not Children of Man.
No, I think that's the next Children. One. The, no. I'm. Where am I?
The last one is...
The doctor, I forgot the actor's name, but he was also in... Pacific Rim.
Yeah. Owen.
So Owen, yeah. So he's now dead and gone, and it's the next season, and they were dealing with all the kids. There was an episode with like all the kids would like stop and freeze and then scream.
Yeah.
That's the most recent one. That's where I'm at.
Okay, yeah, because the two... Okay, so that might be the last real like season... And then they switched to the mini series format, where it was like the big, you know, season wide arc. But I think the last one was Miracle Day, which is really it's really good. I'm looking forward to you seeing Miracle Day. Then we could do a whole Torchwood thing.
Trying to finish it up, but you know, and that's the thing. I've been so busy trying to catch up on these other shows. Today, actually, we are recording on Disney Plus Day. I don't know. Did you know that's a thing?
No.
So, yeah, it's a Disney Plus Day today, which won't help you. Except it's probably all through the weekend. So if you're listening,
Disney Plus Day was yesterday.
Yeah. They're throwing a lot of content out. Like Pinocchio, which is just coming out in theaters, is on Disney Plus for the weekend.
I just saw the trailer for that. It looked really good.
It does. So you can watch it on Disney Plus.
Huh.
Thor,
Love and Thunder.
Love and Thunder. Yeah. just launched on there today, and there's something that, like, if you sign up for the first month, it's like $1.99 or some crap like that. Quote us on any of this. They're not sponsoring us. They're not. We're not affiliated with them. I'm just. It's kind of interesting because there's some things on there. I still haven't seen She-Hulk.
I haven't seen that either.
I haven't. If anybody out there can believe this, I have yet to watch one episode of Ring of Power.
I know. I wanted to talk to you about that.
Yeah.
Because there's Ring of Power. And what's the other one? There's. I thought there were two Tolkien shows out there. There was Ring of Power and. Oh.
No.
It's just Ring of Power? I feel like there's another
one. And there's a whole other Tolkien thing that we need to talk about, too, because the rights. The estate just sold the rights.
I know. And we didn't buy it.
No, I don't have that kind of cash.
I was going to beef up my PayPal account and.
Yeah. But I'm hoping that for this trip that I'm able to. I don't know. It's like if Amazon, if that's one of the shows that you can download on your iPad and watch. But
you saw the thing where those crypto weirdos bought the NFT of the concept art book for Dune, and they thought that gave them all of the rights to Dune.
Really?
The property? Yeah.
That's
you didn't see that?
No.
That was
poor choice.
They spent like $16 million on like an NFT.
And
first
they,
of all, that's of the, that
of,
the,
NFT. Of the artwork.
Not,
or something.
Not that the NFT is a waste. It's just the fact of they didn't do the research before they bought the thing.
They just bought a book. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're like, hey, we can now do this. And like, no.
No, you can't.
You bought a book. Thank you for playing.
Golly.
I'm going to continue to dilute this whiskey bourbon.
You really don't like that rum.
We've got plenty of other rums. Pick a floor rum. Take it home with you.
We'll finish this one. It was a very long pour. I'm just going to finish it.
Yeah. You know, we're kind of at that time for another break, but should we just blow through it?
Yeah, blow through it.
Just keep going.
It's good. It's funny. We used to be more regimented. Now we just don't care. And I'm sure people are out there asking this, and I know.
All 12 of
listener,
them.
Yeah, all of you. That's probably what you're thinking is, I thought you guys were going to do a radio show. Did we ever, like, finish the story on that?
No, I don't think we did.
So here's the thing. We did get off a radio show, and we seriously thought about it, and we are so busy, we have no time to do the legwork.
We didn't have time to go through the contracts and deliverables for obtaining said show, not even to
produce the
manage
show,
and produce the show. It's like,
I mean, to produce an hour of content, it would take you guys probably an easy 20 hours a week to produce 1 hour of a good show.
Well, no.
Oh, no. Absolutely not.
No.
We could throw together a 1 hour show in 45 minutes.
Okay.
Not literally 45 minutes, but like
46.
It's they basically said, do your podcast.
Yeah, but is that sustainable?
The fundraising is the part that
That's the problem. Is
Tyrek.com.
Tyrek.com.
See, I listened.
So, and that's one of the things where we need to bring a certain amount of sponsorship, whatever else we would be able to keep.
Yeah,
and maybe like if we really put time into this outside of what we do, we might monetize the show. But we don't. We do it. You know, you and I were talking while we're waiting on Garrick today. We do this because it's just fucking fun.
By the way, I need Hankook AT3s, a size if it's an expedition.
I can get you a discount on those.
Okay.
Okay.
We'll talk afterwards.
From Tyrek.
Yeah.
Tyrek.com.
They're due soon.
You should consider the Continental Extreme.
No. Those are going on the truck. Okay. My truck. I'm going to replace what's on the expedition. What's on the expedition now?
I told you if you come to my office and you look around the parking lot,
There
is a noticeable quantity of cars that are. Running the Continental Extreme Contact DW06s. Specifically because everyone in my department, hey, what kind of tire you should get? This one?
That one. Yeah, it works in everything. Yeah.
Well, no. If I lived up north, I might get something different, but I live in Florida.
I wouldn't put them on my Jeep.
I would.
It will look like a Yankee four-wheel drive, though. It would look weird.
That big Yankee four.
Yeah.
You never heard what a Yankee four-wheel drive is?
No.
That's when you'll take a four-wheel drive, jack up the sky, and put street tires on it.
Really?
That's a Yankee four-wheel drive.
Yeah. Never heard that before.
Yeah.
Huh.
Go to North Georgia and they'll tell you what a Yankee four-wheel drive looks like.
I've lived in the South for 20 years.
If you don't have BG2s or Toyo Big Countries, you got the wrong tire.
Toyo Big Country?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just saying.
That's fair.
Meh.
Ish.
If it doesn't make more noise than the truck itself on the road from the road noise, wah, and big and heavy. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, that knobbies.
Yeah, like, you know, 33 and a half mutters.
Oh, God. No, thanks. No, thanks. Yeah. My last Jeep, I had 33s on it, but I didn't do the suspension lift. I had, they call them pizza cutters. They're 33s, yeah, but they're narrower, mm-hmm, so they don't run when you turn.
Hmm. We're just gonna make that stupid Stallone face at one another all night, and
for the listeners out there, I'm sitting awkwardly off to the side watching these two.
If it gets oddly silent for absolutely no reason,
yeah, that's it.
Drink.
The what?
Do you want to talk about that song?
I don't. I freaking hate that song.
Oh, it's fucking great.
It's not a great song. It's like. So like everything about Las Vegas you would hear from a really seedy bar at the end of the strip.
Okay, so Sean thinks that we talked about this a couple times. I kind of remember talking about it.
I don't remember.
I saw this again on a TikTok. I saw this on a TikTok. So the story is this guy is talking about, you know, he played his Getting It On soundtrack, his Doing It playlist, right?
Yeah.
And he has this song. And after 2 years, his girlfriend's like, don't know why you play that song. I not only hate it, it actually makes me sick to my stomach thinking about sex and me having to listen to that song. And once he knew that, he was like, oh, shit, it was really awkward. They tried to figure it out. He ended up removing the song. But she could tell that in his mind,
he was
doing it to that song. And so she was like, we can't have sex. No. And so their relationship fell apart. And it's the worst ever.
This song is freaking great. I love it. I've had that song stuck in my head. And I think we should play it for everybody. In case
Hudson Mohawk.
Okay. I will play it.
Satin Panthers.
I'll play it as the out music if I never have to listen to it on this show again.
Okay. That's fair.
All right. I'm witness to this. This is a binding verbal contract.
But you also, because we also had an out song picked.
Post credit we had picked.
Oh, that's post credit? Okay.
I thought.
Oh, we could do post credit.
That way we don't have to play very much of this song.
You really hate that song.
I do. It was just like the whole, and you're over there going, yeah, yeah.
I think that song is
is this weird sounding part going to drop?
So this song has honestly become like the new Rickrolling in one of my groups of friends at work. And it's almost a challenge. You have to try to get a picture of the most romantic setting you can possibly capture in an image, but have this song like playing in the background. So you have, you know, like a YouTube playlist up and you see the logo for it. It's fucking hilarious.
No, I'm good.
I love it. Oh my God.
I'm good.
This is like when someone chews into a microphone and I can hear it.
Yeah.
But for you, it's this song.
Yeah,
it's great.
Yeah,
I just had this very weird parallel watching you guys both sitting in the booth of the Muppet Show, commenting on everything that's going around.
We're like the Statler and Waldorf of humans.
Exactly, the most sensational, inspirational, celebrational. This is what we call the Rum and Nerdy Show.
Do you know what's good about this song? Nothing.
Well, it didn't take much.
Didn't take much.
Statler and Waldorf.
Better than Rosencrantz and Goldstein.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, we're pretty much at that time. So should we just do our thank yous and then play this ugly fucking song?
This travesty of a song that you don't like? Yeah.
Yeah. This is like, it sounds like if you throw like a DJ and a 1995 keyboard down a stair.
It sounds like...
But not like any stair, like a San Francisco staircase.
It sounds like the Chemical Brothers if you remove all the power tools.
Okay.
Anybody a Chemical Brothers song? No? Okay.
It was more like Pet Shop Boys played really poorly.
No, that was that other... I like the Pet Shop Boys.
That was that other thing.
Oh, that
was the other song?
Atlas, yeah. The Battles? Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
I like that song, too. I'm a musical
that,
weirdo.
That one I was fine with until the guy started singing.
Yeah, like Struggling Cats.
That's underwater. Yeah, Battles. That's on the list of... If that comes on, my wife will just immediately change the channel or hit me or something. She hates it. Oh, does she hate it. I enjoy it, though. battles.
Yeah.
Atlas.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Uh huh.
Atlas Shrug.
Atlas Obscura.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, actually, I know what I was going to say. It sounds like the music that Ross Geller played in Friends when he had his keyboard.
Yeah, I don't remember that. Sandy just finished binging the whole rewatching the whole series, but
Seinfeld.
I played video games.
Yes, Ross Geller from Seinfeld.
No, oh, but she binge watched like all like 8 seasons.
She did. Yeah.
Oh dear lord.
Yeah,
that's a lot of work.
If you didn't get through Seinfeld, The Office, or Friends during 2020, you pandemicked wrong.
Oh, but I watched a lot of.
I watched Outer Banks nonstop, like all 13 episodes.
Real fast, I want to throw, because we are running out of time, I want to throw this out there.
Okay.
I've been playing a new video game.
Candy Crush?
Saints Row. Saints Row. It's like Grand Theft Auto, but more just absolutely crazy weird off the wall.
What's the premise?
You
give me a location.
It's kind of like the same kind of shtick. You're in this town and it's open world. You can go around, steal cars, whatever.
Like Blade Runner?
You're basically, you and your friends, each friend is kind of in this different gang that's local. And you say, screw it, we're going to start our own gang. And you just go and do random weird things. But it's hilarious. It's hilarious.
Present day?
Slightly in the future, maybe, but mostly
slightly
present
in
day.
The future, maybe. Okay,
but so it's like here's the thing:
the last season of Parks and Rec.
You can steal any car and take it and put it in your garage. And when you put it in your garage, you can like, I'm going to change this body, this bumper, this. There's one of the cars that you get. We're sitting there because we're with Brian and I are playing. And he goes, dude, you got to check this out. And he shows me, and there's modifications, and I turn this car into the Batmobile, the original series Batmobile.
The Adam West Batmobile?
Yeah.
Huh.
So, like, with the glass, I mean, it's not exact, but it's really, really close.
Batman.
Yeah.
Oh.
So it's cool, because you just customize vehicles and everything else. And
That's cool.
It's hilarious.
Sweet.
So I recommend it, Saints Row. That's our video game of the quarter that we're recommending right now. But anyway, DemoDavePro.com.
What?
That's the next part.
Yeah, that is the next part. I'd like to thank our good friend Dave Martin.
DemoDavePro.com.
Check us out on our website, rumandnerdy.com. That's A-N-D.
And all the social medias at rumandnerdy.com. Also A-N-D.
No.com.
We should never switch responsibilities on the clothing again.
Yeah, you always screw me up whenever you try to do that. Would you like to redo all of that, but correctly?
No, because it's hilarious.
I enjoyed watching it.
It is funny. Anyway, check us out on all those things. Thanks, Dave. We love you guys. Sean, thanks for coming in.
Yeah.
Would you like to plug anything? I mean, you don't really have your own website or art or things that you do per se.
Nothing.
You already plugged YouTube and Tire Rack and
and not that we get paid for any of those things.
Total Wine, you can pick up a bottle of Malort.
Yeah.
We can't speak highly enough about Malort and its value as a gag gift.
You can buy that now here?
Yeah, you can.
Malort,
hand to God, Total Wine.
We didn't have to go to Chicago to do it.
We didn't. Although I have the official Chicago one that came back.
So awful.
And it's
so awful.
I think it tastes a little better because it still has the bathtub ring in the bottle.
If it tastes better, the only plus to that is that it's not a completely full bottle now. That's the only, positive.
It's so shitty. It's the worst drink ever.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, there's not much to report. Other than by the time this airs, we will all be on planes in different places on the planet.
You and I are going to London.
Yeah. By the way, at this point, there'll be, 9 days in, 10 days into the observation of the Queen's death? So called.
No. This is tomorrow. This episode's tomorrow.
The Queen died yesterday.
Oh, so this airs tomorrow?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought this was like a week ahead.
No.
All right, cool. We've been talking about getting a week ahead for...
Ever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And honestly, we might not have a next week's episode unless we can figure out when to record next week's episode in the next.
We are staying at the same hotel, so it is possible.
For you and I, he's not going there.
So
I get to join with Zoom.
He joined by Zoom, right?
Maybe. But then I've got to take all like the microphones. No, don't take
it. It'll just be with God.
Yeah. We'll figure it out. Anyway, all that said, thank you very much. We love you and
stay nerdy, my friends.
Believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home.
And grace will lead me home.
The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life.